Several years ago, a man came up to me when I in my English Bible class at Nimitz, my church, or New Vision Baptist, and he asked me to pray for him. He wanted assurance of salvation. You know, I prayed for him, but in talking to him, he was not a believer, so I shared the gospel. You'd think that he desperately wanted to know that his sins are forgiven and he has eternal life, but he didn't believe. He came back next week. He said, "Will I get another chance to accept Jesus after I die?" And I said that he would not. He said, "What if people pray for me?" I said, "The day my mom died was the day I stopped praying for her to accept Christ." Why? Because the only chance you have is during your life, however long, however short that may be. Once you die, it's too late. And, he came a few more times, but it seemed he always had more questions, and I saw no evidence of conversion. I mean, the last time he came to my Bible study, he was saying, "Well, if I could just see Jesus in person." Do you think that would make a difference if Jesus appeared to him in person? Do you think that would make any difference? Yes? No?
No.
No. Why is that?
Well, the Pharisee during that time, they see Jesus in person, right? They saw the miracle. They still don't believe.
They don't believe. And if you're not convinced from his word, his appearing to you isn't going to change anything. Now, I haven't seen him for several years. He's about close to my age. And, whether he trusted in Christ or not, I don't know. And, he really made me angry because he's desperately wanting to know. He's desperately wanting assurance of salvation, but he won't trust in the one who can give it to him. And, I don't think it was lack of evidence, like you mentioned with the Pharisees. It's a hard heart. You know, it didn't matter what anybody said, he wasn't going to believe. And like, I hope for his own well-being that he did put his faith and trust in Jesus Christ as his Savior. Because if he didn't, it's too late. And the only thing he has awaiting him now is he's going to face Jesus at the great white throne, and then it's going to be too late. Last time I was here, we looked at Habakkuk, and in Habakkuk, I shared that the righteous man shall live by faith, and I quoted Habakkuk 2, verse 4. Just a second. Oh, wrong book. Nahum is not going to help me. Maybe some other time, Nahum. "Behold, this for the proud one. His soul is not right within him, but the righteous will live by his faith." And you see, remember in Habakkuk that Habakkuk was lamenting that God wasn't doing anything about the evil that was going on around him. And Habakkuk said, "Well, I am doing something. I'm just going to send the Chaldeans your way," which was basically God was punishing evil with even more evil. And, Habakkuk lamented about that. But then, God spoke to him and he spoke to Habakkuk. And basically, the righteous living by faith, they'll experience God's deliverance. They'll experience abundant life. As long as they're faithful, they trust in God. And they can be trusted. And the righteous shall live by faith. And that's what we saw in Habakkuk. Well, what does it mean to live by faith? Because I just explained it's trusting in God, being faithful to his word and obeying him. But we're going to look at these next few Sundays, as long as I'm here, and I don't get swallowed up into the abyss. But there's a lot of definitions of faith that you hear out there today. Oh, well, if you just pray hard enough, if you just believe hard enough, it'll happen. Well, that's not faith, that's presumption. Did any of you see the movie Miracle on 34th Street? Okay, well, it came out in 1947, and I know you're going to have a hard time believing this. I was not around in 1947. But it's about Kris Kringle. He's an elderly man, and he claims to be Santa Claus. And so, you know, of course, they're questioning him, and ultimately, a judge has to make the ruling whether or not he's Santa Claus. And I won't give the story away, but one thing that I heard a couple times in the movie, faith is believing in things when common sense tells you not to. Well, there may be some truth in that. I mean, if you look at Hebrews 11, a lot of things that these, it didn't make any sense for him to build the ark or for Abraham to leave his homeland. But, you know, when we pray in faith. You know, we pray according to God's will. We are in submission to God's will. Because you see, there's some teaching out there. It's better known as Word of Faith Prosperity Gospel. If you're into this, you're going down the wrong street, because they teach, you know, you're a little God. God spoke things into existence. You can do the same thing by faith. You just speak it and you declare it. You can speak prosperity. You can speak healing if you're sick, blessing. You know, you can speak whatever you want into existence. For example, are you sick? Isaiah 53, by his stripes I am healed. So I claim that right now and I declare healing. A couple of problems there. One, you're taking it out of context. And two, if you're not healed, They'll always blame you. Well, you didn't have enough faith. You doubted. But you see, friends, God isn't subject to our whims. It's the other way around. We belong to Him. You know, I like the way my pastor in Dallas defined faith. Dr. Robert Jeffers, First Baptist Dallas, where we sing forever. Faith is believing in things when common sense tells you not to. Oh, I'm sorry. Wrong one. I already said that, didn't I? Okay. Sorry, you know, give me a couple minutes of grace, you know, before you open up the bottomless pit. Faith is believing that God will do what He's promised to do in His Word. You know, God's made promises. Like, whoever calls the name of the Lord will be saved. You put your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, you have eternal life. And we're going to look at the righteous shall live by faith today and the next couple times I'm here, as long as the trapdoor stays closed, because it's quoted three times in the New Testament, twice by Paul, once by the writers of Hebrew. And if we want to be men and women of faith, then we need to know what it means to live by faith. And our verse is Romans 1:16 and 17. Do not put it up there. I think most of you know this from memory. So I want us all to say it together by memory. Now, looking at your Bibles, Romans 1:16 and 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to all who believe, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. But the righteous man shall live by faith. I'm reading from the Inspired Version, the New American Standard. Someone just gave me a brand new Robbie Study Bible last week. Well, let's look at two things. Let's look at, you know, why we should boast in the gospel, why we shouldn't be ashamed, and what sets the gospel apart from other religions. Has anybody ever studied Romans? It's a fascinating book. As a matter of fact, were you saying yes or no?
Yes. Awesome.
Okay, one honest person. Anybody else? Tony hit her hand up good. Yeah, you know, I really love Romans, you know, because Romans answers the question. that I think everyone has. How can I be right with God? Now, maybe not everyone's going to ask you that, but pretty much everyone's going to be thinking that. You see, the reason a lot of people fear death is because they don't know what's going to happen. You know, I remember a rabbi just saying point blank, I don't know what happens after you die. My sister has a book on six Jewish viewpoints in regard to the afterlife. Now, obviously, all six views can't be right. Actually, none of them are right because God has made it very clear in His Word. If you trust in Jesus as your Savior, you have eternal life, for now and for eternity. If you don't, you'll face God's judgment, spend eternity separated from God in hell. If you don't like me preaching about hell, then your complaint is with Jesus, because He talked about it more than anybody else. Paul wrote this from Corinth, and he was going to take a collection for the needy saint in Jerusalem. And after that, then his plan was to go to Spain, because he wanted to go where the gospel hadn't been preached, but he was going to stop off in Rome. It was a well-established church. He had not visited it yet, but he really wanted to visit there and have a ministry of mutual encouragement. He was eager to preach the gospel. And see, the first reason that we shouldn't be ashamed, you know why we shouldn't boast, not be ashamed? Look at verse 16. Paul wasn't. See, Paul was anxious to visit Rome. Verse 15, that he's eager to preach the gospel in Rome. You see, it's God's power for salvation. That's the first reason why he wasn't ashamed. You know, most people believe they'll be saved by their good works. Well, you know, I believe God's going to look at my good deeds, He'll look at my bad deeds, and He'll weigh them. And I'm sure my good deeds will outweigh my bad deeds. Well, are you sure about that? Are you relying on your own power to give you eternal life, save you from sin, or God's power? See, the Greek word for power is dunamis. You know what word comes from that? Kaboom, dynamite. But you see, it's the power of God for salvation. It's a lot more powerful. I mean, it's the power of God to save us from God's judgment and God's wrath for all eternity. D.L. Moody, he was a famous evangelist. He put it well. He went beyond dynamite. What he said, that power, it's like a lion in its cage. You know, open the door to let him get out. And then get out of the way, because here he comes. Rah! I know you're awake now, Kevin.
Right.
But you see, most people, they really believe they're going to make it to heaven on their own good works. I know my mom did until the day she died. She firmly believed she was a good person. But you see, people don't realize the effects of sin and its penalty. If you have one of these, a credit card, and this one's actually 20 years old. It's got a picture of me when I was young and handsome. You know, you keep using it to pay for stuff. The debt is going to add up. It's eventually going to be due. Well, we all got a debt of sin. And actually, sin, it was passed from Adam down to the entire human race. Nobody is exempt, but that debt's going to keep adding up and up, and we could never, you know, we could never repay it. And you see, you know, when you're sharing with someone, you tell them about sin, they're going to admit, they won't deny they've sinned, but they don't realize its consequences because their sin is against a holy God. And so We should not be ashamed of the gospel, because it's God's power to save us. It's the only way which we can be saved. And we should be proud of it, not boast. Listen, if you get engaged, I guarantee you're going to tell everyone about it. When I graduated from Dallas Theological Seminary, I wanted everyone to know. And so, you know, we need to share the gospel. Because our earthly lives are only temporary. We're not going to be here forever. Most of you will probably outlive me, but that's another story. A friend posted a satire on his Facebook page. Did any of you see the movie The Dead Poets Society? He actually made it The Dead Preachers Society. And see, the point was that we can always learn by listening to sermons from preachers who have passed on. But you know what? One day, us preachers, we're all going to be members of the Dead Preachers Society. I'll probably get there before y'all, but that's another story. And, you know, we want to leave a good legacy while we're here, but our lives are only a small fraction of eternity, and where we're going to spend it is the most important decision during our earthly lives. And only the gospel can save us from God's judgment and eternity in hell. But you see, it's for all who believe. You know, still in verse 16. I don't care what country you're from. I don't care how old you are, whether you're man or woman, male or female. Yeah, I just said that. Rich or poor, it's for you. Now, Paul addressed it to the Jew first. And because remember that God's promises were to the Jews, but the Jews rejected Jesus. And in Acts on Paul's, you know, would go into the synagogues and they kicked him out. He said three times, we are going to the Gentiles. Now, is anybody in here Jewish? Okay, I am. But anyway, you know, you might think it's God's done with the Jews. But God reveals his plan for the Jews in Romans 9 through 11. Time doesn't permit me to discuss it, but God is not done with a Jew. And so, you know, there are always going to be Jews that hear the gospel message and believe. It may be a minority, but there are Jews who are being saved. The gospel has the power to do it, and it's for all who believe. So we've seen first, you know, why we shouldn't be ashamed. But let's also look at what makes the gospel so special, in verse 17. Now, I think first we need to understand what the gospel is. I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians 15. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Three essentials. Christ died for our sins, was buried, and he was raised on the third day. When you share the gospel, you know, you need to present that. I mean, you hear a lot of these TV preachers, oh, God just wants to bless you, just believe in him. Well, no, you need to believe, you need to preach the gospel message. You notice it didn't originate with Paul. He got it from the scriptures. He received it from God. And you see, two things about the gospel. It shows us God's righteousness. We're in verse 17. No other religion can do that. You know, when you share the gospel with someone, you know, and they think they're good. Well, I'm a good person. You know, I don't do this or that. And they may be good people. I think all of us probably know some good, moral, upright people. They are good in every sense of the word, but if they're not believers in Jesus Christ, they are lost for eternity. And you see, if our being good people is what's going to get us in heaven, guess what? Everyone's going to go. You know why? Because we think we're good by our own standards. You know, we'll compare ourselves with someone else who's worse off. See, I don't do what he does. Be careful, because while you're doing that, somebody else may be comparing themselves to you, thinking that they're better. But you see, God's judgment is not his by our standards, by his. He is perfectly holy. He is perfectly righteous. That is stated all over his word. And can you attain to that? If you do, you'll be the first person. But God's going to judge us by his standards. See, the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. We see that God is perfectly holy and righteous. So, brings the next question, you know, how can we attain to it? Well, we can't. Romans 5, I'm going to give you a little term, imputed righteousness. It's simply when you trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're trusting in his finished work on the cross, nothing more, nothing less. When you do that, God is satisfied with what he did on the cross. God declares you righteous. It's called imputed righteous, and he's satisfied. You know, you're not perfect. Granted, you're still the same person, but God declares you as righteous. That's imputed righteousness. So we see in the gospel, we see God's righteousness, but how we can attain to it. And that didn't originate with Habakkuk. It didn't originate with Paul. It's from God. You know, we read the passage, Romans 1, 16, 17. But the righteous man shall live by faith. If it's in capital letters, then the New Testament writer is qualifying, he's taking that from the Old Testament. Now, he may have used the Hebrew Old Testament, or he may have used the Greek version of the Old Testament, the Septuagint. But, you know, we saw in Habakkuk that, you know, the righteous people, they will trust God and obey him. In this passage, it has to do with salvation. The righteous man shall live by faith. We put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. I think 20 minutes have gone by. Go ahead and open the trap door. It's been nice seeing you all. Goodbye. Let me take this with me. I'm thirsty. But you see, you know, it all begins with faith. Anybody know what happened in 1517? I definitely wasn't around then. Anybody? What? Someone said it. What was that? Come on, say so before the trapdoor opens. Okay, well, the Reformation. Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to the Wittenberg door. I mean, he'd been a Catholic priest. And he didn't like the way that they were selling indulgences. You know, is your loved one in heaven? I mean, is your loved one in purgatory? You pay indulgences, it'll shorten his time. You know, maybe if he's in purgatory for 3 million years, maybe it'll shorten his time by 100 years. You know, it's like buying your way to heaven. But the Reformation, it's got its five solas. Faith alone, Christ alone, Scripture alone, grace alone, to the glory of God alone. Now next week, unless the bottomless pit opens, we're going to look at Galatians, where Paul uses this, and we're going to see what happens when you try to live by a faith plus works gospel. But the only way to please God is by faith. And you see, Romans, it explains the only way we can be right with God. Do you know you'll spend eternity in heaven after you die? If you give any other answer than you're trusting in the finished work of Christ on the cross, you're trusting your own good works. But Romans tells us we're sinners. We're worthy of death, eternal separation from God. But it tells us about God's love. And because of his love, God sent his son Jesus Christ to die for our sins, give us eternal life. You know, if you've never trusted in Christ as your Savior, I can't think of a better time than now. I mean, don't make the mistake that this other man I shared with you at the beginning of the sermon. I don't know if he ever trusted in Christ or not. I mean, he heard the gospel several times, and I can only hope for his own sake, his own well-being, that he did. Because you know what? You want assurance of salvation? He's in his word. You trust in Christ? You got it. God's going to do what he's promised according to his word. You know, don't be one of the proud ones like Habakkuk, like Habakkuk wrote, the proud and the righteous. And you see, for us as believers, you know, believing by faith, it's just the beginning. You know, by faith we live a life in obedience to God. You know, His Holy Spirit works in us to help us to do that. And, you know, we need to share this message. Paul wasn't ashamed of it. You know, God will give you opportunities to share. I'm not saying you got to take every person, turn it into a heaven or hell confrontation. I have a friend in Dallas. He's a pastor. And 4 years ago, he rode his bike all the way across the United States. That's about 2,800 miles or 44 kilometers. He did it in 30 days. And the whole purpose was to have conversations about Jesus. And he wrote a book about that. And God will give you those opportunities. You know, if you've trusted in Jesus as your Savior, then your message is really the only message that people need to hear. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5 that we are ambassadors from Christ. Because when you trust in Him, He will save all who believe. You know, His righteousness is revealed from faith to faith. It's, you know, literally, it's out of faith into faith. It's kind of like from start to finish. That's the good news. Have you trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior? Do you know you have eternal life? And now's the time to trust if you never have. And if you have trust in Christ, you know He's put here for a purpose. I think all of us in here have loved ones that we want to see in heaven. You know, we have the words of eternal life, so ask God to give you opportunities for conversations about Jesus. And before we sing forever again, let me pray for us. Father, thank You just for Your word. Thank You for the message of salvation, that it's the only way we can be saved, by grace and faith. I pray that if anyone is here who's never trusted in Jesus, they would do so. And would You help us to be men and women of faith, that we live a life of obedience to You, and that we have opportunities to share the gospel. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.